Honey, I gotta go. I'm going on a quest.
Hey, how are you?
Hello, Canada.
You like the dunk tank?
Buckle my glass. Hey, rep, kiss my ass.
We messed up.
Things got out of hand. Drake's is in bad shape.
Don't take my gold away.
You're wearing your rubber boots tonight.
Season 3 of the Rubber Boots Pod is brought to you by iDrinkCoffee.com, the best coffee and espresso machine supplier in the country, bar none. And by the Gansevoort Resort in Turks and Caicos, absolute paradise, the number one resort on the number one beach in the world. And hey, if your company would like to sponsor a segment on the pod, DM us on Twitter or Instagram at Rubber Boots Pod. Lester, hit it before we fire your ass again.
Season 3 of the podcast, Duthie's Rubber Boots Podcast. We want to thank you for listening. We're sure you never thought we'd last. Oh, no. We're going to talk nothing, very little sports with your host, Jimmy, or James. And now you know for sure that it's going to be a blast. It's going to be a blast, oh yes, because this is the podcast.
My daughter's school is 9 minutes from my house. 9 minutes.
Walking or driving?
Driving. Took me 1 hour and 13 minutes.
What?
To get to her school today. 1 hour.
How's that even possible?
Yeah.
Well, you know where I live up in
the
little town of Aurora. I live right near the country.
Yeah.
The township of King is next door. Her school is in the middle of King.
Yeah.
And I don't know what the hell happened, but there must have been a massive accident because I turn onto the road leading to her school, so it's literally about a 7 minute drive down this road, straight down.
Yeah.
And everybody's stopped and everybody's turning around. Everybody's turning around, so the road is blocked. So I turn off that road, I double back, go across to the next road. Everybody stopped and turning around. So I hit my Waze. Do you got the Waze?
Yeah, I like Waze.
Google Maps myself.
Google Maps.
The Waze sends me. I was stuck, by the way. The second time I turned around, now I have to go through a stop sign, and I'm the 100th car to go. Have to go through a stop sign. So there's a half an hour. And Waze made me go back, like up the opposite way of the school, about 5 miles.
Yeah.
Over 5 miles, down 10 miles, and then back up to the school.
So didn't Gracie just walk? Like she would have been there in like 30 minutes.
Yeah, I know. It's not a great podcast story. It's the Traffic Tales podcast here.
Did you find out what happened?
No, I don't. I phoned the school and they said, don't worry, she's not, because Gracie's very responsible. She was worried she was going to be marked late. But
last year,
the school said, nobody's getting marked late today. There's nobody here.
My kids on the report card had 27 late.
How many were due to gambling issues?
Most of them, and then they'd come in and you'd be like, they'd ask like Barrett or Austin, be like, why are you late? And they just look at me.
Right.
I'm like, it's dad's fault.
The entire schedule today was messed up. So that made me late for an appointment downtown. I had to go downtown for an appointment. And I didn't know what time the podcast was today because, Puffy wanted it at 1, then at 1:30, then at 2.
I'm raising children, James. Well, I have my responsibilities.
You know, I happen to have a little something I prepared because of Puffy's schedule. Go something like this.
Puffy's changing schedule is messing with mine. Uh-huh. Puffy's changing schedule is wasting my time.
Yep, yep.
Puffy's changing schedule is blowing my mind again.
Young Money.
Again.
We the best music.
DJ Khaled.
We the best music. Why does he do that for every song?
I think it's the best.
That's DJ Khaled, right?
Yeah, we should say, we the best podcast every time we start.
It's flat money.
That's our version of it.
My wife was confused about Khalid and DJ Khaled. That was a sign of oldness, wouldn't you say? We had to explain it to her. She likes the Khalid. Anyway, welcome to the Traffic Talk podcast here. I was going to say here on TSN. It's not on TSN.
No.
It's an independent production supported by TSN. There's Puffy. There's Sirius Lester over there. Mm-hmm. Stoff is in the booth today. How was your Thanksgiving? We should probably do the week that was because that leads us to Thanksgiving talk.
Let's discuss the week that was with James Duthie and the Rubber Boots podcast crew.
Good Thanksgiving, all?
That was good.
Mine was pretty good. I spent it at work.
It was quiet.
What? You did you eat alone?
No. I had
Play your clarinet.
So do I. That's right.
Trombone.
Never gonna like live that story down. No, I had my band, the Bone Diggers.
Yes.
Played on Friday.
See, he's just accepted it now. Yeah, he's given in. That's victory for us.
As we win.
Had a gig at the Rex, and then on Saturday.
Boneyard Groove?
No,
who was it really? What
no,
is
it was
that?
It was Lester McLean.
The Lester.
Oh, sorry.
Actually, Trio. We played.
What's
Trio.
The other band called again?
Grooveyard.
Grooveyard. Yeah, okay, thank you.
So I did that Friday. And Saturday, I had a wedding. One of our colleagues, my colleagues here at TSN, Alex, he got married.
Whoa, whoa, nice. Whoa, 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 whoa. Why wasn't there no talent invites to the wedding? Was there any talent there?
I was the talent.
Yeah. So Lester. All
right. I guess we were on the B level talent, I guess. It is a question. Let me ask you something, Puff. I mean, might take this opportunity to ask this. Now that we're doing this Puffcast.
Oh, the Puffcast.
The Puffcast.
That will be the breakoff when he gets bigger.
I feel one more season and then I'm ready for prime time.
Do you feel like you're talent here?
Yes, I am.
Yes. Yeah.
Talent, by the way, for our listeners, they call it in the business, the people who are on camera or on the mic on the radio are called talent, which was probably a sarcastic comment by
some
producers
some people
back in the day.
Behind the scenes that take offense to that term.
What, talent?
Yeah, they don't.
But I think I actually think it was probably developed as a sarcastic in the 1940s or something.
Yeah. I can see that.
Yeah. I like it.
Do you really?
Yeah, I feel it's reaffirming.
Yeah.
Talent on the set. Thank you. I'll be there in just a second, please.
I'll step aside.
So we started a new tradition at my house. I made the turkey, by the way. I'm becoming quite
Seriously?
A turkey connoisseur.
Nice.
It was only my second one because I don't know how to cook. But
I mean, to make the turkey, you're just putting it in an oven.
No. I watched who's the Gordon Ramsay?
Okay.
Watched a YouTube video.
Nice.
And he told me how to, I mixed up a little garlic, parsley, butter in the dish.
And my favorite way to cook it is roasted with lemon, parsley, and garlic. It's fantastically aromatic, really easy to do, keeps the meat succulent, and tastes absolutely delicious.
Nice.
And then I massaged underneath the skin of the turkey. Massaged all the butter in there. It was very sexual. Yeah, it was a very sexual experience for me.
Did you stuff it?
I stuffed it with. I put a couple of half onions and a lemon inside the turkey. That's how I stuffed it. I didn't make my own stuffing though.
Oh no,
no. And then we played. The family played a beer pong after the turkey dinner
with beer.
Oh well, you had a choice. So I thought that was a responsible thing for a father to do with his 17-year-old daughter, 15-year-old daughter.
So the girls chose beer, obviously.
18-year-old son. No, there wasn't a lot of drinking going. But my daughters were extremely talented at this game, and that was concerning to me.
It's not their first rodeo.
No, they were excellent at it. And then what did I do? Then we binge-watched Animal Kingdom, which is
nice.
A new show I've been watching. You know, I was thinking, I always need new shows.
Yeah.
Because that's what, during when winter comes, I basically just watch a lot of TV. Watch sports and a lot of TV.
In the summer, you just golf.
So maybe we could not do a regular segment here, but throw out any new shows you're watching, and any of the listeners can write in and tell me, recommend a good show.
You guys all watch the Netflix shows.
Yeah.
While I watch basic cable. I'm still very traditional with the big networks.
I can't do commercials anymore.
What is wrong with you?
I can't do that.
You don't need a little break to recharge the batteries?
Even when I'm watching a taped show and I have to fast forward the commercials, I find it annoying.
Really?
I like that little half second of black when you're watching it on Netflix.
I like to take that minute, take a leak. I'm old school.
So Animal Kingdom is a very good show. I can recommend that one. It's like about a kind of a crime family in on the California coast.
You know who stars in it?
Scott Speedman. Scott Speedman.
He's a local boy.
He slept with my buddy's girlfriend.
A long time ago.
Yeah, a long, long time ago.
Was it when he was on Felicity?
When he was on Felicity. My buddy actually had two bad experiences. First, that Scott Speedman, allegedly.
Is that a bad experience?
No, I don't even think
you're
he
not
was that.
Marry
I don't even
girl,
think he was that bitter.
Yeah.
He's like, hey,
it just shows you.
Blank. I can't say her name because she broke up with me, but she apparently slept with that guy on Felicity. Uh-huh. He's like, that's pretty cool. Even better story. Couple years before that, he was dating a waitress from the Yucatan Liquor Stand in Ottawa.
Nice.
Named that bar before here. And she went to a U2 concert in Montreal.
Okay.
And so the next week, I'm like, how's Jane or whatever her name was? And he's like, oh, you're not going to believe this. She ran off with The Edge.
Seriously.
Wow. Yeah. She like she went to see the concert. She got like, you know,
the point
from the security guy.
She got selected because of her talent.
And she was gone. Like she was on tour with you too. She was just gone.
So this guy must be pretty good looking. Because I'm guessing
Taddy's a good looking Italian guy. He's my buddy.
Like, yeah. He must have had some like very attractive girlfriends.
Oh. Yeah. And they all Scott Speedman, The Edge.
Who's better?
He's got some stories right there.
Wow.
Like who would be a better pull for a lady?
Scott Speedman or The Edge?
Yeah. Scott Speedman, Felicity. Like, that's where he's kind of in his prime for, like, the ladies' love.
Why don't you do your hypothetical this week? If you had to make love to one of these men, but, I mean, would you make love to The Edge?
The Edge or is Scott a bigger Speedman? World star.
He's more international,
but
for sure.
Scott Speedman.
Very sexy.
At Felicity hype?
Like, I'll be honest with you. Right now, I have no idea who Scott Speedman is. I don't know what this guy looks like.
He hasn't been in any major, major roles.
I never watched Felicity.
I thought he'd break out.
Search him on the phone for Lester. But I had to look him up the other day because he's 44 or 42 or
right
something like that.
Age.
He's looking
good. He was a swimmer, a competitive
Ellen
swimmer.
Barkin plays the lead role. Very good in this show. Yeah. Anyway, so there's one scene last night in the last show I was watching. I bring this up apropos of nothing, but it was very erotic. There's a lot of porn. There's a lot of porn.
Phone down now.
There's a lot of porn scenes.
Really?
Yeah, there's one guy, one of the sons in the family, just he's doing coke all the time and just banging like crazy.
Really?
So there's a lot of little porn scenes in there. But they had this one scene, they're heisting a church, and one of the brothers gets involved with one of the church-going ladies in order to get an inside on the church heist.
As you would.
And she doesn't, like, they hook up, but she won't have sex. So they get naked, and they're face to face, and she says to him, "You touch yourself," and then she touches herself, but she won't let him do, like, they won't touch. So they're standing right there,
like right face to face,
and it was very erotic.
Hold on, I might have a hypothetical for you guys,
based on
that. Now, right. For $1 million.
Well, hold on. Should we? Are you ready? This is your hypo this week.
Yeah.
You mean?
Yeah, I think I'm gonna do the hypo right now.
Theme it up.
You're directing, eh? I see.
Yo, 1, 2, 1, 2. These hypotheticals are messing with my mind. These hypotheticals, what's gonna be this time? These hypotheticals are blowing my mind. Again. These hypotheticals.
So wait, now we had a hockey one we were going to do, but...
but this one might be better.
All right, okay.
So along those same lines, with another person in this room, would you be able to go face-to-face naked and finish to completion your business for $1 million? But you both have to finish for the money.
What is wrong with you?
So you and me are in a room.
Yeah, in a room.
A la the Animal Kingdom scene I just described.
Yes.
We're naked.
Buck naked. And we have to look each other in the eyes.
Like 3 inches apart, because that's what they were.
That's close. You're not touching, but you're right close together. And finish your business
in five minutes. I don't know.
$1 million, and the cash is in the room.
Can you shut your eyes?
No, you have to look directly. Now, your eyes can be dead. Like, you can be dead inside. You don't have to be, like, thinking about the person. You can be thinking about whatever.
I'm going to tweet that hypothetical this week, and I'm going to tweet out, once again, the close-up of the photo of you from New Jack Summer.
you had that sexy look
in your eye and the hairy chest.
I think I can get it done. The worst part would be if somebody, after like 45 seconds, is like, "I'm done. Hurry up. we got $1 million to win."
That would be stuff. I'm out. 35 seconds. If he was face-to-face with me.
Here's my question. Can I wear boots?
Rubber boots. Sure.
If you wear boots, I'm out in 45 seconds.
I'm out.
Cowboy boots.
I don't know that I could get it done. I think I would have. First of all, there would be a half an hour of laughing. But $1 million would be on the line. Like, a guy is there with the bag of money.
Right in the room with you. He can look the other way, though. He doesn't have to see what's going on.
I'm
going to
jump in here and say, if I had the right prep, and again, I could wear rubber.
No, there's
boots.
No fluffing.
There's no fluffing. You got to walk in the room cold.
Cold. No, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about a couple shots. That's what I'm talking about. That's the prep I need.
I thought you meant a fluffer.
No.
I need a couple of shots and... of heroin.
Yeah, no performance enhancing drugs. No.
Oh yeah, exactly. A bottle, an entire bottle of Cialis.
No, you gotta do it.
I don't know that I could, I don't know that I could get it done.
Would you be willing to try it?
Like, the worst is, for the purpose of this podcast,
the worst is having to leave the room after failing. You got no money. No, just
are we still on camera on the podcast?
Yeah.
You haven't won any money, have you? Like, this is not going to come to fruition.
Yeah, he's been winning a lot of money lately, actually. Well,
he has this million. Like, imagine if he has this million
dollars. Well, if I win $60 million on Friday with the lotto...
Then you'll do this? Well, you'll offer us a million for us?
There's going to be 120 people going at it.
There's going to be like rooms, separate rooms. Oh, God.
I think that I would be willing to do it for the million, as long as it would not end up on social media or something.
No,
if it was a private thing.
We would have cameras,
I wouldn't do it
though.
For the pod. Well, but I don't. I think I would fail. It would have to be a time limit, too.
Yeah,
you have
5 minutes.
To put the clock. No, 5 minutes, forget that.
Okay, 15 minutes?
I don't know, buddy. It takes me like 2 hours usually anyway. I mean,
you got to wine and dine yourself?
I'd have to romance you first, tell you stories. This one time when I won my first Gemini. Come on over to the couch.
You know, it's working.
It's gonna go like this. It's gonna go, Puffy, I don't think I could do this. Oh no.
I'm already there, buddy. Just look me in the eyes deeper.
Stoff, would you partake in this event?
Not likely. I mean, just the closeness, the trajectory of in which ways things can fly.
We've already confirmed we're orgy guys, so that stuff's already there.
Yeah.
Oh, true.
Well, that was a very nicely improvised edition of Puffy.
That was good.
Puffy's Hypotheticals. I was going to let
It's alarming how quickly Puffy went there.
I know. I can't believe it.
You hear those stories, it got me thinking.
Like I said, that's episode one of the Puffcast.
I was going to have the one of our beloved sponsors, the Gansevoort, sponsor Puffy's Hypotheticals this week. I think I'll sponsor another segment.
Let them breathe a little.
But our friends at iDrinkCoffee.com will sponsor this edition of the Rod Smith Recap.
Middle of the morning, can't keep my eyes open, cause I got to have a cup of Java. I got to have a cup of Java, so I better log on. iDrinkCoffee.com.
Episode 2 got off to a rough start with a rather distracted Puffy.
Impressive physique.
Are you on Tinder or something right now? No. What are you doing?
Distracted and indecisive.
I was going to say Ryan Johansson. Mitch Marner is nasty.
At least Lester knows what he wants.
I'm going to go with Brett Burns. He could do something like that.
Then Duthie finally realized where his was buttered and gave Roddy a shout out.
Roddy can go 20, 25 deep if he has to.
Yeah, like
he's a legend.
Not sure what he's referring to, but yes, in whatever connotation, that statement is accurate. Later on, always affable and eager guest Jeff O'Neill joined his favorite pod again. But things got heated as the line of questioning intensified.
Did you drink excessively to the point of blackout during your time at Yale?
Buddy, off. I told you never to do this again.
Another entertaining, informative, uplifting O-Dog interview. Then Puffy entered a gentleman's wager with internship intern finalist, Scott Reynolds.
Eddie, and if it remains tied 1-1, then I'm going to have a big payday. So.
In the 65th minute.
Yeah, Puffy's got 400 on
I'm
that.
I'm also betting on that game.
Before drastically raising the stakes.
The winner gets to shoot the loser in the head.
Wow. What is wrong with
you? So one of us is in trouble.
What is wrong with you?
Yikes, you can't shoot Scott. He writes gorgeous ballads about Roddy's greatest... assets.
The science of Rod Smith's compound.
You see, kids? It looked like he was talking about Roddy's but then he changed it at the last second, and that made it even more humorous. Comedy. It's fun. Till next time.
Awesome.
That's it. Nice. There's the Rod Smith recap right there.
Rod's two for two this season.
We're going to have him in eventually, right? Have him in
studio. Oh, of course. It'll be a staple.
He got very Ron
Burgundy at the end explaining the jokes. I quite enjoyed it. Speaking of Scott Reynolds, a tour de force performance last week.
He was very strong. It's going to be hard to top him.
Shout out to Norm D'Entremont, one of our listeners, who said, who dubbed the intern internship the intern internship hiring fiasco, or double IIHF. So maybe we should call it the double IIHF from now forward.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
So not to intimidate all the other internship candidates, by the way, Meghan Wong of CyberCrime fame will be on. She will be our internship guest in just a few minutes' time.
Perfect.
But Scott Reynolds, we introduced a character last week. We talked about introducing a character, 1999 Puffy.
Yes.
After the successful debut last year of 1999 Sarah Orleski, who, for new listeners, appeared to me in a dream.
Uh-huh.
Sarah Orleski appeared to me in a dream, but she was not current day Sarah Orleski. She was 1999 Sarah Orleski. She was a young, impressionable co-ed. And she ended up, what happened to her? She ended up being...
Didn't her and Roddy run off? Victor Newman's daughter, or Lester,
Newman's daughter.
I think she got with Amelia at
her time. Her and Roddy did not run off. Yeah, Roddy was her dad.
Oh, yeah.
She hooked up with Amelia. We don't know what's going on.
I still want the results of the DNA test.
It was Amelia.
She was attending the Gary Lawless School of Broadcasting, I believe, in Winnipeg. and then we don't know why. She ran off with Amelia. Roddy was upset. We haven't picked up that storyline just yet. It's a long season.
Yeah.
But anyway, so we thought 1999 Puffy would be a good character.
Yes.
Now, like most things on the podcast, we would have probably let this die.
100%.
Because we would have forgotten about it.
Yeah.
But that's the magic of the IIHF, the intern internship hiring fiasco.
Exactly.
Scott Reynolds, creative soul that he is, after producing two songs, sent me something this week that he's designed a series of shorts.
Yes.
Based on 1999 Puffy,
uh-huh,
which show in story arc fashion the progress, or the...
How I went from a college...
Yeah, Puffy. How Puffy became Puffy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So how he went from 1999 innocent Puffy to 2018 degenerate, gambling addicted, alcohol-fused Puffy.
You're just naming my good points.
So over the next few weeks... we're going to bring these little shorts to you one by one. He's already done three.
Jesus.
Oh, my God.
So this is installment one of a 1999 Puffy.
Hey, everyone. It's 1999, and this is Sean, a voice diary entry number one. I'm just starting my first semester at university and looking forward to my long but rewarding journey towards a career in neurosurgery. I've saved all my money from working hard all summer and have a strict and detailed financial plan to get me through the year. I also...
Hey, Sean!
Oh, hey, Zach. This is my roommate, Zach.
Sean, I'm going to throw $40 in New England for this Monday night football that's about to kick off. You want in on this?
What? You can gamble on sports?
Yeah, man. You can take the points, bet the over, the under. You can even bet on the coin toss. Here, I'll bet you $5 it's heads.
Okay. Sure, I guess.
Oh, man, tails. So now I gotta give you $5.
Uh-oh. And this money is just mine now? Just for free?
Yup.
Oh, my God. What is this feeling I'm having right now? I feel powerful. What's happening to me?
So that's voice diary that's much number one of 1999. I just can't wait to see what happens next.
That is wild stuff.
That was good.
Which brings us to the intern candidate from this week, who's going to be Meghan Wong. But first, let's get to Lester's theme. By the way, it's brought to you by the Gansevoort Resort in Turks and Caicos.
Rubber Boots Podcast Intern Search. We need someone to mail the merch when listeners win contests. Coffee, t-shirts, James's book. When need something, you're on the hook. Bring coffees to the set. Help pay off Puff's gambling debt. Just be there to scratch our wrist. The bottom line is you'll be up.
Shut your mouth. Hey, man, I'm just talking about the Rubber Boots Podcast Intern.
Here she is, ladies and gentlemen. Intern internship candidate number two, Meghan Wong. How are you, Meghan?
Good. How are you guys?
We're excellent. Puffy's here. Lester's here. Staff is here. We're thrilled to have you on. What's going on?
I'm so happy.
What's going on in Vancouver?
It's the normal weather and just at work right now, so just taking my lunch break off.
What do you do, Meghan? I was trying to look up your extensive resume that you sent us about 6 months ago, but like many things in life, I lost it. So I remember
I'm not surprised.
Yeah, we were very impressed with you because you had some social media background and you were in cybercrime. So what is your current job that you're working at right now?
I am a crime prevention and personal safety coordinator right now.
What does that mean?
So basically, I work at a campus and I deal with thefts on campus and look at personal safety issues that people have, whether it's domestic violence or cyberbullying, or if they just don't feel safe on campus, they come talk to me about that. Oh,
that's a great job.
That is.
That's an important.
Sounds a little made up, doesn't it?
Just kidding.
I just want to sound important, okay?
No, that's an important job you're doing right now. Besides, I don't want to get into the bullying and stuff, but what's the number one stuff that gets stolen on campus?
Laptops.
Oh, yeah.
Those bastards.
People just leave them, and then the MacBook Pros are really high-profile ones.
That's what I got.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Someday when I start doing my own podcast and we eliminate stuff, I'm going to do them on the MacBook Pros.
Okay.
And we're recording.
And you did some social media before, right?
I did. I did some social media for Shing Weddings. So it was my friend's wedding event planning company. So I helped her out for a few years. And then I did the social media for Free Van City, which published events around the city that were free for people to attend to.
Nice.
And then I guess I continue on with school, and then I kind of lost track of social media for helping out. But I'm still in the running for the intern, so I don't want to be like out of it.
How did you fall in love with us as a group? Because I know you have.
I remember seeing you guys on the like top podcast.
Oh wow!
And I started listening to you guys on the way to work, and it actually made the drive to work more bearable.
Less painful. It's still really painful, but not as severely painful as it used to be.
Exactly. So I would save you guys for like Thursdays, I think, last season that you guys sent out the podcast, and I would just be like, listen to it on the way and to and from work, and then it just made me a lot happier.
Where are you out in Richmond, or are you out in Coquitlam?
I'm out in Burnaby, actually.
Oh, Burnaby. A lot of commutes in Vancouver because there's no freaking highway. Yeah.
I forgot you were a Vancouver guy.
I've said on the record, I love Vancouver. It's probably Ottawa's my hometown, but Vancouver might be my favorite city, but the commutes were hell.
Burnaby's lovely. I have some family out there.
Yeah?
Yes.
I came out to Toronto, though. It was not the... I came out for training.
I know.
It took me about 2 hours to travel from Niagara Falls down to downtown Toronto. And I've never been in that kind of like commute before.
Meghan would fit really well onto my new podcast, Traffic Story, Traffic Tales. The one I'm launching next week. Yes, I know Meghan. So Meghan wanted to meet us.
Oh,
and
okay.
She came in town for a course, but I was still on summer break.
Yeah.
And Puffy was in rehab, gambling rehab. Lester was on tour. And so we just couldn't work it out. But I'm sorry that happened, because it would have been nice to have our first intern. And that would have, you know, FaceTime with us might have put you in the lead,
for sure.
Because the bonding that would have happened. Yeah, I know. Mm. Well, maybe we'll FaceTime you later so we can have eye to eye eye contact.
Speaking of FaceTime, for $1 million, Meghan.
No. Meghan wasn't listening. We had a hypothetical this week, Meghan, that was... It was,
you'll be glad you were spared.
Yeah, you'll be glad that you came on after the hypothetical, okay?
Okay. I always look forward to the hypotheticals, though.
I don't know about this one, Meghan. This one might be the one that gets the CRTC involved, gets us off the airwaves. Meghan, I want you to sell... That's going to sound wrong. Sell yourself. But Meghan, why should you be our intern?
I'm absolutely dedicated to the job. I'm taking time out for my lunch right now to give you guys a call. So, and I'm 3 hours behind you guys so I can get work done before I go to work and after work.
That's good.
And I have social media handles, and I can get you guys going for Instagram, Twitter, and get more content up there and think of more ideas. I also have a background in cybercrime, so I know that Puff has some dick pics.
Yes.
Just to let you know, things are archived on the internet, so I'd be very careful about that. Everything's archived, so once you put everything online, it's captured forever.
This is that the cloud?
Whoa.
It's not the cloud.
I've heard the cloud's bad.
The cloud is very bad. I wouldn't store anything on there.
So
yeah, the
can you destroy the cloud?
Everything.
So everything that's ever been on the internet is still out there somewhere.
Yes, somewhere. Wow. Someone will take a screenshot of it. Someone has a copy of it.
Even like, the stuff that was on dial-up? Like back in the day,
simpatico.
Maybe. I don't know. I can't remember when the archive started, but if you put dick pics out back then.
1999, Puffy. I don't know.
Now, you're not talking about text, because I don't think Puffy ever like put one on website like puffysdick.com. I think it, you know, we were just talking about.
I have never done. For the record, I have never put
it. Sure?
Well, with your wifey, yeah. You might have sent one before.
As long as you have to put it up on the internet, you're fine.
Okay. That'll be good.
Okay.
So, cybercrime is what intrigues us. And like, we imagine you as, you know, very much like a CBS drama.
Yeah, CIS.
You know, starring Scott Speedman.
Yeah.
As cybercrime.
Yeah.
What, have you had any interesting cases? I mean, cybercrime is, or is it just you sitting at a computer, boring the hell out of us?
It's me sitting at the computer and looking at different websites. So I published a paper about white supremacists a couple of years ago.
Okay.
Ooh. So that's very different from...
Did you have to go, like, infiltrate their, go to their sites and all that?
Yeah, I did have to go on their websites, look at what they were saying, and try to categorize them as how they use the internet.
Mm. Now, do you have to actually pose as someone who's interested then and start, you know, have a name and go on there to get that?
As part of ethics, I can't do that. But if I look through the posts and everything, I can see what they're talking about. Once they privatize the forums, I can't look at it. Then I have to go on to a different forum website.
That must be disturbing as hell to read some of that stuff.
Oh, yeah, it is. They blamed, I can't remember who they were blaming, but it was our fault, because I'm not white, so it's like our fault for the reason why there was a walkout.
I know how you feel, Meghan.
I'm just kidding.
Yeah, no, that's, but I, you know, you're doing good work.
Yeah.
I think we could use kind of a moral compass on the show. Serious Lester is kind of like that. But
well, yeah, I'll be honest with you. I after a couple of years with you guys, I'm starting to shift my beliefs a little bit.
The compass has been broken.
Maybe Meghan can reset it for
you. Maybe
that will be her job.
Me, yes.
Well, listen, Meghan, we keep sending us the ideas, and we really like you. You sound like a wonderful person, and we love Vancouver.
Yes.
And maybe if we get into round three, we can come out to interview you just to use an excuse to go to Vancouver.
Well, we will be in Vancouver. Ooh. For the World Juniors.
So we're gonna have to stretch this out.
Yeah.
So Meghan, okay. Puffy, and I will be there. Lester, he'll be fired by then. He's not invited to the World Juniors.
Neither
is Scott.
Oh,
but Puffy and I will do a sit down interview with you.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to grill your ass in Vancouver at the World Juniors. Okay.
Man.
All right. We can even invite you to. You can even come to the set if you want. We'll invite you in to see the where Bob and I make our magic. We're called talent, you know.
I miss you guys.
All right, Meghan. Thanks for coming on, and please continue to send us ideas. I don't know if you heard what Scott Reynolds did last week, but he's writing songs and producing segments. So there's a lot of competition for this job. It's highly sought after. Okay.
Okay. All right. Will do. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. That's Meghan Wong from Vancouver. Nice. What a nice lady.
Oh, lovely. Fantastic.
Hey, and doing
she
important
seems to do
work.
Really important.
By the way, I was obviously never going to have her participate in that hypothetical. I just thought it was
thanks
funny.
Thanks for clarifying. It was funny, and we knew you were joking.
Well timed. And I'm sure if he's joking. For God's sakes, Lester.
See, I like how we're getting a variety. Like Scott is completely off the wall.
Yeah.
Right. Yes. He's rogue.
Yeah.
And Meghan is just stability. She represents stability. And
But both big fans. Both big fans.
Both big fans of the show. And lots more coming. I had all sorts of suggestions this week. Laura Cope sent me some stuff. Thomas, one of our new guys.
Oh, nice.
Photographer sent me some stuff. But I said, well, we won't use their ideas until they get on. We won't use their good stuff. So the IIHF continues. It's sponsored by our friends at the Gansevoort Resort.
You work too hard, you need a vacation. So be like Jimmy and go to Turks and Caicos. Luxury and class of 5-star resort. You must book the Gansevoort. A nice villa at the Gansevoort. Come to the Gansevoort.
Going to the Gansevoort in January, book my next trip.
Oh, baby.
How many times have you been there?
Six or something like that, maybe seven. It's going to happen. And the four of us are going to get to the Gansevoort.
I've never been to Turks. That'd be fantastic.
It's going to be a net. We'll do pods every day down there. Maybe we'll just be on all the time.
It's 24 hours.
24/7. We'll just leave the pod on.
But we'd have the tunes going. It'd be a lot of fun down there.
That'd be fantastic. Would you bring your guitar?
Absolutely.
No, I was talking to Stoff. I don't know.
You're bringing the clarinet.
Before we leave, I don't know if this is going to be a new segment, but Puff and I were doing a Senators game yesterday, and really, the TV career for me is just the start. What I will be known for when I die will be as a screenwriter and film producer.
Yeah.
That's my true calling.
Mm.
And I have a bunch of ideas in my head, and I didn't want to share them because I wanted to keep them private because people will steal them.
Yeah.
But maybe if we hire Meghan, she'll make sure.
Well, I also have a friend who does, he's a lawyer, and he does wills and stuff like that. So he could probably lawyer this up for us.
So let's mark down this day. What is the date today?
Today's October 9th.
October 9th, 2018. I'm putting this patent on this copyright idea.
These ideas are owned.
Yeah, this was the film idea I had the other day. I have a lot of these, but I thought I'd start sharing them with you, and then maybe we can flesh it out.
Yeah.
And some of the brilliant listeners that we have can send in ideas to further along. I just will make note as further to the legal thing that they will not get any screenwriting credits.
No.
I will take their ideas, use them for my own benefit.
I heard Matt Damon on a podcast talking about writing Good Will Hunting, and he wrote it himself, but then him and Ben Affleck got together, fleshed it out. Academy Award winning movie.
So is he saying he did most of the work?
No, it was a bit of a different story when he had it.
I think what Puff's saying is you should collaborate with him.
Yeah.
Oh, I see.
Ben Affleck. You're more of a Matt Damon. Like, I would be in Armageddon. You'd be doing the Talented Mr. Ripley.
I think you're more of a Tug Speedman.
Yeah, because that's the skilled movies, and you're just doing you're doing the hero movies. Is that what you're
good
saying?
Looking.
Oh,
hero
hello,
movie guys.
The Bourne Identity. That's not a hero action movie.
That's nerds.
Four films grossing about $1 billion.
Bruce Willis saving us from rocks. Come on.
Well, they did. They worked on Project Greenlight, maybe, which was a show where they would hire some, kind of like our internship. They'd hire some guy to make his first movie. So that's kind of like what we'll do here. We'll flesh out a screenplay. So here's my idea. All right. It starts out as it looks like a serial killer movie. There's a character who personifies evil.
Okay.
He's killing. He's doing all sorts of horrible things. He's the personification of evil. But nobody knows. He's also brilliant.
Okay.
You know, in a Dexter type fashion, nobody knows what he's doing.
Sort of like the guy from Seven.
Yes, I would say that. Then, all of a sudden, twist, boom, 20 minutes in, he gets hit by a truck. You're like, whoa, what's going on here? This is crazy. Okay, I thought this was going to be the whole story.
Yeah.
Next thing you know, scene in a hospital. He's alive, but he's dying.
Okay.
But he has signed his organ donor card. So they're harvesting his organs.
Mm-hmm.
These organs get sent different people, heart, eyes. Those people, now we start focusing on their lives. The evil has crept with him.
Oh, wow.
Right?
Okay.
And so, you know, the 9-year-old boy who has his eyes suddenly murdering the family cat, something like that.
Oh, wow.
I haven't fleshed it out too much.
I don't think it should be the cat. I think it should be like a sibling.
Or maybe it's just one part. I thought, okay, so it could be like six organs donated and all these people start going evil.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this could be a horror film, or I can make it artsy. Quentin Tarantino, just a dark drama like Seven, like you're talking about there. What are you thinking?
I like it. I like it.
Right.
I would like the opportunity to write some music for that film.
Well, Puffy has already said he wants to...
I want to play the sheriff.
Right. He wants to play a sheriff in the film.
I'm going
to
have a mustache, and I'm going to be a little bit dodgy.
Right. So you could be in the film, too.
Oh,
like playing music in a bar sort of thing when one of the murders occurs.
If I'm
going to
be in the film, then maybe I wouldn't mind being a detective or perhaps the sibling of one of these people.
But the rule. You've said it before on the podcast. You will die first.
Oh, well, yes, well.
The black guys always die.
Now, could I play the cat that is killed?
The cat could be named Stoff. All right? Nice. You'll be named after a character.
You know what? I'm going to add a little something. Because you said it's like this character is like a seven-ish, seven type of character.
Right.
So there'd be seven organs.
Now you're playing off other movies.
No, but then they just call it Seven again.
Well, and there
Seven
was
a, again sounds like was a teen movie.
There was an organ transplant movie called, I believe, 8 pounds with or seven
yeah,
pounds
seven
with
pounds,
Will Smith,
yeah.
Was a happier story where Will Smith sort of killed himself. He felt bad and he didn't need to donate his organs to all these people.
I never saw it.
I never saw it.
Good movie, but this is going to be much darker than that. Now,
Who do you have attached for directing?
I'm not sure yet. Probably, it depends where I want to go with it.
Yeah.
You know, I'm thinking maybe a Peter Berg.
Oh, Peter Berg would be good.
If it's more an intellectual movie, a Ron Howard, perhaps.
Okay. If Peter Berg's starring, Mark Wahlberg is going to be taking my detective role or my sheriff role.
Who's the guy who does all the blow-up movies? Michael Mann?
Michael Mann, yeah, I think so.
No. What about Spike Lee, man?
Spike Lee? That Spike Lee joint?
For the record, he was John never Singleton. Getting to Spike Lee.
I may direct the film myself.
Yeah.
The star will be Scott Speedman.
Scott Speedman.
No, but maybe, I don't know, maybe then I thought maybe it could be a Netflix series.
Okay.
Right? Where we follow all these people's lives that got the organs. Or maybe I've got too ambitious. And maybe it should just be his eyes that get donated.
No,
and they end up in like a 10-year-old boy. And the boy starts to see the killings that have happened before. And his dad is the Sheriff Cameron, with the mustache. And he's like, what's going on with you, son? I'm seeing things. It's almost like the I See Dead people. And we have to cast a Haley Joel Osment type character for that. And then he's trying to solve it. And at the same time, he solves the serial. I don't know. So there's a lot of possibilities.
See, the second movie just described also sounds pretty good.
Yeah, pretty good.
Maybe he sees what the other donor recipients are seeing, and he sees them murdering.
Right.
Not bad.
Yeah, that's
I like the idea of a series.
That's even better.
I like the idea of a
Netflix series.
And you're right. So you have the eyes. Mm-hmm. So someone gets the eyes. You do a 1 hour on
But they can't all be psycho killers. They have to be, there's got to be different things.
Yeah, well, I understand that, but could they all be psycho killers?
Have
different ways of killing people?
Maybe my guy was a schizophrenic who had multiple personalities, and all the organs get one of his personalities.
Ah. Wow.
You have to tell a lot of stories in that first 20 minutes. Down.
That's a good idea.
Okay, so I'm going to flesh this out throughout the season, and I will write this at some point, write the screenplay, and it's going to be a big hit. So don't any screenwriters out there, don't be stealing my because we have it on record right here.
Yeah.
And then Puffy threw an idea out me today. You had your own screenplay. Tell me this one.
Mine is a guy who gets the ability to see that so he'll know if he's been in some place for the last time of his life.
What do you mean?
So it's not like he knows when he's going to die, but like he'll know that he was at Niagara Falls for the last
time. Is it a voice in his head, like Field of Dreams?
It's a text message.
Oh, out of the nowhere from a mysterious number.
Yeah.
And it says, you will never be here again.
Yeah, you'll never be here again. So at first it's actually a good thing because it sort of teaches him to live in the moment. He becomes a better father, a better husband, a better everything.
Isn't he terrified by these texts?
At first he's scared, but then he realizes that he's like seizing the day, like he's becoming a great person. But then the world becomes smaller and smaller because there's places he now can't go.
You will never be at this Mucho Burrito down the street.
And then the last one is he's driving to work, and then he gets a text message saying, you'll never go home. So then he knows, I'm going to die now. So he's worried. So he slowly, drives to the hospital.
I'm riveted by this. I'm just watching you tell me, let alone seeing the
film. He gets to the hospital and he calls his family. He's like, I'm going to die, like probably a heart attack or something. Like, you got to get here. So the whole family goes there. Hospital blows up. Terrorist attack. Boom.
Wow. Well, wait to spoil it.
Fast and the Furious 9. That's what it's going to be called.
Wow.
Part of a franchise.
No, okay. We have to have working titles. Fast and the Furious 9. Yeah.
Vin Diesel stars in it.
That's
my God.
It's the next installment of Fast and the Furious franchise.
Yours is going to be called, okay, I got to think of this for a second.
Oh, Fast and the Furious 9, maybe 10. The Rock will be in it too. It's going to be fantastic. It's going to be a huge hit.
Yours is going to be called Can't Go Back.
Oh.
And it's going to be starring.
I need a big star because the story is going to have some holes in it.
Can't Go Back. It's going to be starring
Liam Neeson.
Now maybe
Liam Neeson would be good. Not so much an action movie.
I want it to be I want the dad to be a little bit younger.
Oh.
Like 45.
Okay.
Scott Speedman.
I don't know if Scott Speedman's getting the opening audience.
Do you think
I
we could ever get Scott Speedman on the podcast?
Now? I think we could.
And we could ask him if he really had sex with my friend's girlfriend.
Would that be true?
Okay, my film, the working title I was originally thinking of it as a dark comedy.
Yeah.
And then the working title was Evil Organs.
That sounds like
That's a comedy.
Yeah.
So we'll come up with a better title for it, and maybe our listeners can suggest titles. I was thinking like Bad Harvest, like
organ
they harvest
donor.
Organs. Organ Donor is a terrible name.
Okay, but if I was Organ Donor, pretty good.
Bad Donor.
Bad Donor, that sounds...
It sounds somewhere like Bad Donuts.
Evil Harvest.
You know what? I was just going to say Cruel Evil. Harvest.
Cruel Harvest.
Harvest.
Cruel Harvest.
This Christmas.
Ben Harvest is Cruel Harvest.
I'm looking right into your eyes and I'm thinking,
Sean Cameron is the sheriff that wanted it all. Scott Speedman is the doctor that had no idea what he was doing.
That's true. The thing is, you need
Channing
to have-
Tatum is the man who thought he got a new heart and instead got a new license to kill.
That's pretty good.
Meghan Wong is the cybercrime specialist trying to solve it all.
And John Cena.
It's a great cast. You need a really good name actor, though, to play the bad guy. Because people are going to think, oh, they're the star of the movie. And then when they die, boom.
I want really the bad guy in...
It's kind of like when Drew Barrymore died at the
New Country for Old Men.
Yeah, that guy.
Yeah, what's his name?
Oh, my God.
I can't think of it. He's from Latin America somewhere. I'm gonna... Peru? Javier Bardem?
Javier Bardem. I think he's from Spain.
I think he's Spanish. Yeah. I was going to say Benicio Toro. Del Toro.
Yeah, he'd be pretty good, too.
Right.
Yeah.
Maybe Josh we'll get Brolin. The director of Brokeback Mountain. Actually, he should direct our hypothetical.
I'm telling you, he'd make it erotic.
Anyway, that's it.
Hold on. I have to say, if we're talking about this, I do actually also have a screenplay idea.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And the idea is that a traveling musician is going...
Goes on the road. Nothing ever happens.
No. He's on the road.
Nobody throws panties on the stage.
He's also a hitman.
Oh. So,
I like that.
You know?
Starring... Kevin Hart.
Working title, Serious Lester.
Serial Lester.
Yeah, nice. Serial Lester. That's good.
Anyway, send us your ideas. I got an idea as well. Look at this. This is what happens. This is like a writer's room. This is how a production company starts.
Exactly. Yeah. Now, I don't have an actual plot. I just have a working title. This is a political thriller.
Okay.
It's The Guy on the Left.
Very nice.
Based on a book as well.
Who should play me in a film? Should it be Ben Stiller, the lookalike I used to get, the doppelganger? Seth Meyers, also. Wow. Or the most common one I get,
Ed Helms,
including a bunch of teenage girls at the Gansevoort in Turks and Caicos.
Remember,
I told you my buddy Mike, my good buddy Mike, the whole Dave Chappelle thing?
Dave Coulier.
That's hilarious.
Poor Mike. He listened to the pod. But
he felt shame.
He's the best guy ever. So his daughter brought a bunch of their friends a grad trip.
Okay.
Nicest guy in the world brings all these girls to the Gansevoort for their grad trip.
That's amazing.
And a few of them thought I was like they thought I was Ed Helms.
Really?
Like they didn't think he looked like Ed Helms. Like, are you Ed Helms? Did I get you that much? You know?
No, not that
Andy
much.
Bernard from The Office? I don't know. And the guy from Blossom I used to get. If anybody can go back that far, the drug-addicted brother from Blossom.
Oh, I remember him. Anthony Russo or something.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That was the other one I got.
You can see that.
Interesting.
I get Zac Efron a lot.
You used to get Screech.
Yeah.
You don't like that I say that. Yeah. And he's in jail right now, isn't he? Because he could play you in that film.
That's not going to get the number.
He needs the work. So that when I didn't have my dreads, I used to get Denzel Washington. No, I'm serious.
Seriously,
the worst thing is the guy.
So did I.
What?
Well,
I'm not kidding.
What you did before you had your dreads?
Yeah, all the time, Denzel.
No, I can believe that because you're a good looking man.
Yeah,
but there's nothing
not
worse
like Denzel.
There's nothing worse than the person who says, "I get a lot of people," and it's a person who's way better looking than they are.
Yeah.
We used to have a friend, I'm not going to name her name, and she's an attractive lady.
Uh-huh.
But she always used to say, everybody thinks I look like Jennifer Aniston. And I'd be like, you don't look remotely like Jennifer Aniston. So you got to play it down.
I do get Zac Efron, though.
You do not get Zac Efron.
People like High School Musical, I'm like, yep, that was me.
I got Tom Cruise back in high school. Or I told you, the makeup lady used to think I looked like Kevin Costner, Kiko.
Yes. I could see that. I could see Coco.
Legally blind.
Kiko?
Like Kevin
Costner. That was Coco. Anyway.
Kiko. we should cut it off. So we'll have another intern on next week.
Nice.
And please send us your screenplay ideas if you want to develop our script. Either one of our scripts. We have about four.
The Rubber Boot Podcast owns all
rights. So any ideas you suggest to us, we will use. You might get a credit. Like really near the end of the credits when the writing's really small.
And if any actors, especially big name actors, want to attach themselves to our projects, that could be arranged.
The way that Scott Reynolds is producing, he will probably send us a 90-minute version of the film next week.
A rough draft.
Thanks for listening to the Rubber Boots Podcast. We'll see you next week.
Hey, how are you? I got a question that I really want to ask you. Wait, don't hang up. I need to know, so I'm gonna try and push my luck. Are you wearing your rubber boots tonight? Are they purple, yellow, green, or black or white? Are you wearing your rubber boots tonight? Do you like the dunk tank at the fair? Oh, I know it's a little strange. My obsession with your choice of footwear in the rain. And I know that you're on TV.
Rubber boots tonight.